The School of Agriculture was originally founded in the city centre. We sit in a faculty of science, agriculture and engineering. Our school is actually a mixed school. We carry out research in agriculture, in nutrition, also in agribusiness and all around the rural economy. And so we've actually got a very rich mixture of both natural scientists and social scientists, both doing research and training our students in cross-disciplinary thinking.
Academically, there's been prodigious change. You know, we had one computer at this university when I was a student, but we're still using the same experiments in many cases, and we're deriving information from them that the originators could never have dreamt of. So the county councils for Cumberland, Westmorland, Northumberland and Durham got together and they decided that they would try to help the local farming community to use new methods to improve their productivity, their profitability. And they approached what was then Durham University. The College of Science had been developed, which became Armstrong College, and which is now Newcastle University. So they suggested that there should be an agriculture department and that they would help to pay for it. The initial experiments that they did were on farms, but the problem was continuity and control. So they really didn't need a farm, and they negotiated with the Duke of Portland and we got Cockle Park Farm. And this is where the new experiments begin. Palace leaves, the surviving hay meadow, tree field, a pasture plot, hanging leaves, another pasture plot, and rotation plots, which is a Norfolk four-course rotation experiment. And these experiments ran for the next 50 years. And they were designed to bring farmers and their sons in from the surrounding community, and they would come for courses in some cases. There would be lectures in the evenings, but also people came and stayed. There were 6-week and 10-week courses, and the people on them were called squeakers and tweakers. They were actually part of the farming community, and they were taught as this other role. The same professors and lecturers were of course teaching here in Newcastle, and we needed a new building here, and a local veterinary, Clement Stevenson, put up half the money to build a new building where the school could be based.
If you look back at the figures of the past within the school, some of them really stand out. And Clement was a vet from the 19th century, and he was one of the pioneers of understanding and how diseases spread within livestock. And so it was he who actually linked the industrial needs of the farming sector in the Northeast with the research at the School of Agriculture.
The farm itself has changed astonishingly, because there weren't all the big new modern buildings then. It was very much the traditional steading. Professor Gilchrist, who was one of the early professors at the university who had a lot to do with the Palace Leaves experiment, he lived in the tower house, because in those days to get out from Newcastle to Cockle Park meant taking the train to Morpeth, then getting a pony and trap to take you out of the farm 4 miles away. And you had to then stay overnight before you could come back. People just don't appreciate having a farm 18 miles away. Might not be much of a chore today, but it was a very big one then. So Gilchrist travelled round and he provided an advisory service to farmers. And that's why the plots at Palace Leaves are so large. It was so they could bring farmers and stand together in a group, looking around them, and he could talk to the local farming community about what the effects of these new treatments would be. He could see the benefits that they were getting from the use of the new fertilizing materials, from the better management of the livestock and of the grassland, etc. And he was able to travel all around the northeast of England, not just coming into the university to talk to the smaller group of students, and he would give evening lectures to farmers. There were a series of other professors who followed. The next of the great people who comes is a New Zealander, Mac Cooper. That he arrived here like a new broom, and he brought all these people in and they transformed Newcastle. The School of Agriculture grew enormously. He was a very good lecturer. He came across to the farming community very, very well. The farmers would pick up the paper on a Friday, open it, the journal at the farming page, and if it said, Mac Cooper says, doze your sheep now, you can just imagine the Northumbrian farmer putting his bonnet on, taking the stick, poking the dog and going out and dosing the sheep. This man spoke truth.
You've got everything here from these fantastic farm resources, cutting edge lab-based training that you can get inside the school on the main campus site. We also do cross-teaching with other schools across the faculty, so it's a very unique training in agriculture and related topics.
At Newcastle I had such a broad range of things that I learned, everything from genetics to agronomy, really good sound business management, which was delivered by really good lecturers, and I think the business management side and financial side of it was my main interest and something that I've really become involved with since I left the university.
I think it has a good balance between like the practical side and like almost science side of it as well.
There's this people to learn from everywhere, so that's probably the best thing for agri students as well as the course itself. So try and get a bit of a broad horizon of what's actually going on, learn a bit more, see how everyone else does it and take some ideas back home.
We work a lot with crop modelling processes now, which we didn't do before. So you can understand what the information tells you and how it spatially varies, but the real question then is how do you make a decision? So you have to put that information through things like crop models and decision support systems. So there's a lot more focus on that within the university now.
Because we've been here for over 100 years, farmers have got used to coming here for 100 years. We have excellent facilities in terms of meeting rooms and audiovisual equipment that we were able to really do quite a good job of knowledge transfer on an actual working farm. So we can go out, we can listen to the theory, then go out and actually see all this work done in practice.
So this is the Palace Lees field. It was set up in 1896 when the farm came under the university's management. It's a cut hay trial experiment. So the intent here is to measure how much silage is produced on a first cut basis each year. And they set it up so that there's different types of manure and different types of fertiliser regimes. So it's been running for 120 years, which is quite unique to have an experiment that runs that long.
At the moment the farm is about to have quite a bit of investment made in it. We're going to be the centre for plant health and protection, where we'll not just do work here, but we'll also operate a fleet of mobile labs that will be able to go out onto other farms and do various other bits and pieces of research and assessment of crop health. We're also going to have the CDIL Centre, which is a centre for digital innovation and analysis in livestock, basically using modern technology to look at how livestock moves and how we can give farm animals a much better quality of life.
We've a freedom farrowing system called PigSafe that takes into account the welfare of the piglets as well as the sow. In a freedom farrowing system, she can have straw that she could use to make a nest, which is totally natural behaviour. We've put in sloping walls so that the piglets aren't at risk when she lays down. What happens is she lies down against the board and the piglet, if there's one underneath her, is pushed underneath the board into a void so that they're not crushed or anything like that. So that's made a massive difference to the welfare of both the sow and the piglets. We have all sorts of monitors on everything, like temperature, the water being used, the amount of feed that's being used. And we're also using the WeConnect cameras to tell if there's a reduction in movement in the pen, which would be an indicator that there's an issue.
During the war, Nafferton was taken over by the Warraig and managed by the government during the war to try and maximise production. And at the end of the war, rather than offering it to the previous tenant, it was offered to the university or King's College Durham. And they've managed it ever since, and it's obviously developed. One of the reasons for having the farm is that we can use the facilities for the students to look at, and information that we generate, students can use for their education and understanding of how agricultural systems link with one another and make up a viable unit.
These are our field trials where we're looking at organic and conventional crop production systems, and they were set up by Professor Leifert, who's the Professor of Ecological Agriculture here. So it's what we call a factorial trial, which means there's different factors of crop production that we're looking at in this trial, including the crop rotation, where we're comparing organic crop rotation with a conventional crop rotation. Then we're also looking at crop protection methods, which are mainly things like mechanical weed control rather than herbicides, pest control like copper products for fungal diseases, and then netting to control insects. Conventional systems will use all the standard products like pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, growth regulators. And then the third factor is fertility management. So that's how we provide the nutrients to the crops. So again, in organic systems, we rely on more natural products, things like compost, which is made from the manure on the farm. The crop rotation, the legumes provide nitrogen to the crop. And sometimes we use a bit of cattle slurry as well in there. And then on the conventional fertility approach, there we're using to typical bagged fertilizers, so ammonium nitrate, triple superphosphate, potassium chloride, these usual bags of fertilizers you see farmers use. But what's really unique about it is that because it's what I call factorial, it means that basically we have each of those different treatments in combination with everything else. And that's what makes it really interesting scientifically, because then you can really start to pick apart what are the differences between these two systems of crop production.
It's a unique system we've got here, having two herds on the same unit, managed by the same staff.
We split the dairy herd and we manage them as an organic dairy herd and a conventional dairy herd. We've been able to do trials here. We've had a feeding trial trying to improve the quality of milk. Without this facility, we wouldn't have been able to do something like that. For the students, I think they can relate to the research work and the academic papers better if they see where it comes from.
Making sense of all of that data and turning them into useful decision systems that busy farmers can operate out of their businesses is critical. To think ahead about how we can come up with new methods for control, prevention, looking at the science underpinning some of the organic systems is a very important part of the research carried out here.
It is a rewarding thing to do. We work on a university farm, and I never really cease to be amazed by the enthusiasm that every single year shows towards the industry. And many of our alumni, as they refer to, go on to do an awful lot of very, very important jobs, actually in practical agriculture and in the supporting industries.
Some people are managing veg farms, some people are managing arable farms, there's agribusiness consultants. Some people have just went back to work at home and took their knowledge back to improve their own farm and business. It leaves a lot of opportunities for a lot of people.
It's quite exciting, you know, that long history that we've got here, and we're making new history all the time as well, so it'll be a real legacy for students in the future.
We are analysing material and results from the past in ways the people of the time had no concept of. We can do so much more with them. It may be the thing that changes the world in the future.